Salvation is a gift. Do you believe that works done on earth determine a level of reward or responsibility in the kingdom?
Yeah, I do. I think that works have nothing to do with kingdom residence, okay, salvation. But scripture does suggest rewards in the kingdom, you know, are not all the same. I mean, not everybody has the same reward, that kind of thing. You know, 1 Corinthians 3:10-15, I think, suggests this. I'll just read the passage. Paul says, beginning in verse 10, according to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and someone else is building upon it. Let each one take care how he builds upon it. For no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on the foundation, and the foundation is salvation, that's Christ. If anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become manifest, for the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he'll receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he'll suffer loss, though he himself will be saved, but only as through fire. So the works here are not the foundation. The works are what goes on top of the foundation. The works do not replace or displace salvation through Christ. That's very clear in this passage. The works are, you know, something, again, put upon top, you know, in addition to, you know, this status that was gained for us by what someone else did, namely Jesus. So the real question here, is it an all or nothing idea? You know, like are we going to get to a, some people will take this, and again, I've heard this preached too, that, you know, like if you're not, they wouldn't say it this way, but basically, if you're not like nearly perfect, or at least as perfect as I am, the preacher, you know, if you don't have a life of, you know, this endless string of victories here, spiritual victories, or, you know, then you're going to get to heaven. If you don't have more spiritual victories than not, then everything's going to burn up, you know, in flames before your eyes, and you'll be with the Lord empty handed. I think that's bunk. Okay. It's not an all or nothing idea. It's very doubtful. And I think, I doubt that it's a total loss, because what that implies is that on the other side, you have a total success. There are no total successes in discipleship. Why? Because we're people. We're humans. We're fallible. We aren't deities. Okay, we're not God. You know, we're not, by definition, we are imperfect. So if you're going to say that having failures, spiritual failures and struggles with sin, sometimes you lose. You know, you might even lose a lot. It might be a huge struggle, okay? That wipes everything out. I just don't see the coherence of that, because then, you know, you're taking an equally, or you're taking an imperfect scorecard. You know, let's say you have more victories than failures. Your scorecard is still imperfect. And so God, you know, like gives you everything. It's like a total success. And then, you know, if the scales tip the other way, it's a total loss. I don't think that's the picture at all. What I think's going on here, I should just go to a quick reference in 1 Corinthians 4, verse 5. Therefore, do not pronounce judgment before the time, before the Lord comes, who will bring to light the things now hidden in darkness and will disclose the purposes of the heart. Then each one will receive his commendation from God. I think this verse needs to be part of preceding chapter, you know, at least consideration in tandem with 1 Corinthians 3. I think what the point is that everyone is going to suffer some loss and everyone is going to get some reward. But the tallies, as it were, you know, what that amounts to, I don't see any evidence in scripture where it's equal for everybody. I think we're all just going to see, you know, how we could have been used, you know, where we fell short, where we rebelled, where we stumbled, where we just failed. And we'll see, again, what might have been, what God could have done with us in a given circumstance, and we'll suffer loss, but we'll also see what God was able to accomplish with us when we presented ourselves as a useful tool. You know, and that's one of the motivations for holy living, to be useful. You know, it has nothing to do with earning a place in God's family, meriting it enough. It has everything to do, though, with being useful. God wants to use people. He wants to use believers to help other people become believers, to help believers grow, to do things for the kingdom. You have to make yourself useful. And basically, if you're just not a disciple of Jesus, if you're not trying to live, you know, with him as your model, you're going to become pretty darn well useless, at least useless in certain contexts. you know, that's the whole, you know, that's really where the rubber meets the road as far as the debate. You know, do we have Christians that are like 1% useful and 99% useless? Again, ultimately, you know, I don't know. You know, the Spirit of God takes up residence in someone and encourages them, you know, to, you know, prompts them to do certain things. You know, do they believe or not believe? Well, ultimately, I don't have the answer for that. Only the person knows that, and only God knows that, you know, at the end of the day. All I know is that we have to believe to have eternal life, and we need to be grateful. We should want to be useful. We need to be grateful for our salvation and, you know, live accordingly. I mean, those are the clear things that are taught in Scripture. You know, how we take that information and look at, you know, somebody else and wonder, well, I mean, that's a human thing to do. I understand that. But ultimately, we can't use those ideas to determine for someone else, you know, what's really going on there. So I think we need to, you know, we all know people like that. You know, we need to talk to them and be honest with them about their sin. We need to challenge them to think about what's really going on inside. You know, are you really believing the gospel or not? I don't really care that you prayed a prayer 10 years ago and now you've basically taken that and said, well, I said the incantation, I can do whatever I want now. I question that. I question the validity of your faith because, you know, you've given me no choice. You know, I wonder because you've given me reason to wonder, but I can't decide for you. I can't tell. I don't know, but you need to examine yourself. Isn't that a scriptural phrase? Let a man examine himself. Okay, I'm not going to examine you. I'm going to tell you that from what I see, it prompts a concern, but that's about all I can do. I can just tell you I'm concerned. I can't produce the answer for you. Only you can do that. So we need to encourage people, you know, to examine themselves. That's what the New Testament does in you know, any number of places. And I think we ought to stick to that and not try to position ourselves as some sort of wise spiritual authority able to see behind the veil and penetrate a person's mind and really know, you know, what's going on in there. But we can get the person, you know, hopefully to consider themselves and then talk to them about the gospel. The answer is always the same. Whether they were a believer, you know, and now they're just, you know, stuck in sin, or whether they didn't believe at all, the answer is still the same. Do you believe this right now? Do you believe the gospel right now? I don't need a scorecard. I don't need a box score. Okay, I don't need to be omniscient. It doesn't matter. What matters is right now.